And Ian, I do want to start off with this idea of separating that foundry business into what you say in the story is a wholly owned subsidiary that could maybe even have more distance between it and Intel. Explain that to me.
Yeah, I mean, if you are a prospective customer of this, if you're going to give it your crown jewels, your manufacturing, you might be a competitor. So you want to see some kind of separation here. And this is Intel acknowledging that reality, that if you want NVIDIA, if you want AMD as a customer, you've got to show them that there's a gap between that and your product division and that they can trust you. And this is what's going on here.
Is that really what was holding some customers back, or was it actually what they're making?
Well, what Pat Gelsinger said when I spoke to him was like, look, we had to have world-class manufacturing again. We didn't. We've absolutely spent a fortune rushing through these various stages to get ourselves to that level. Now we're in a position where we can say to our customers, hey, come and use us. We're just as good, if not better, than everybody else.
So when we talk about the idea that some of the other projects, including that those plants in Germany, Poland, and even the one in Malaysia, are, I guess, let's just say, being put on ice, for lack of a better term here, Ian. Should we read more into that? Is this the idea of just refocusing on the U.S., basically doing one thing and doing one thing well, rather than trying to spread itself then?
This is financial reality imposing itself. Pat has produced this spending plan, this massive expansion plan that's just no longer supported by the current business levels. He's acknowledging that. He's saying, look, me and the board, and he just told me that now. We went and had a really close look at what we're doing, and we've realigned ourselves with this new reality. In the future, we can open these back up and we can expand into them, and that would be the plan. But for now, we're going to preserve cash to spend on what we really need to spend and what we really need to do.
So the agreement that they're working with Amazon for products and wafers, like, is that a big deal? What does that mean for Intel?
This is the headline. This is what Intel has needed all along. It needs companies like Amazon, one of the biggest spenders on data center chips, to come out and say, okay, yeah, you're good enough, we'll use you. We don't know the exact details. The fabric chip is kind of a networking chip, so that's probably not the mainstream kind of chip that Intel would hope to be making millions and millions of for a company like Amazon. But guess what? It's a start, and it's a good start. And for Intel, if you're an Intel kind of skeptic, you wanted to be seeing these kind of big names associated with that foundry effort, and now they've got one of them, so that obviously helps. We'll see how it pans out, but it really helps.
Give us a sense here about the partnership with Amazon. Obviously, this is, I think, what a lot of investors are sort of latching on to here. Would this have happened if they didn't have a partner of that size and scope?
I mean, this is a very complicated situation. In the past, Amazon used to buy exclusively pretty much from Intel. Over time, it decided to make its own stuff, to design its own chips, which were a partial replacement of what Intel sells it, had TSMC build those chips. Now it's saying, hey, some of those things that kind of replace your stuff, we're going to have you make for us. So that's a partial return of business to Intel. And that's really what Intel is trying to do, to say, hey, if you're not going to buy our stuff, maybe we can make your stuff. And that keeps us in the game. And that's, again, underlines, you know, what that effort is about. And Amazon is giving them at least a glimmer of hope in that effort.